repeat too much of what I've already heard, because some of my content was covered quite thoroughly and beautifully by people like Dr. Lucrecia Ruel. She talked about standards and study design, and these are all important topics that we've come across in our presentations and work. So, I'm Doug Mahon. My colleagues, Don Cowan, started computer science at Waterloo 50, 60 years ago, I'm not sure. He's the founding director, and I've been to him with lots of meetings with him, and in the early days, people about my age or a little bit older would say, oh, I was in your class. And then we started to go to meetings, and my dad was in your class. And not too many years ago, he said, Doug, it happened. Somebody said, my grandfather was in your class. I don't know if that's happened to too many of the faculty here, but it does happen sometimes. So Don is officially Distinguished Professor Emeritus at the University of Waterloo. That makes you retired. And the real bonus is you get free parking, which is not to be sneezed at. Wes Stanfield is a biologist. Some scientists here may know Wes. He's from the Ministry of Natural Resources, retired the Glenora Fisheries. He was a biologist, and he still is active in our projects and work. I'm feeling like a little bit of a fish out of water or a stranger in a strange land. I think I was here in 2018, actually. Much smaller room, smaller group. But it's phenomenal and fantastic to hear the variety of work that's going on, the data that's being processed, and all that kind of thing. I want to talk for just a minute about our funder, Canary. Canary's not funding projects like ours anymore. They're getting out of the business. Now, one of the clauses in our funding agreement was that we had to provide them with enough information so that their little robot spider in the web could crawl around and find our system. Every 10 minutes they come and check, are you up, are you up, are you up, are you up? And yeah, we get hits from them and all that sort of stuff. Well, about a year ago, Research Data Alliance came along and they're taking over the funding of research software development. And Canary had this directory of all the projects that they had funded, and you could go to it and see the status of several hundred systems across the country. They offered that data to the Alliance folks, and they weren't interested. And I don't know if there's anyone here from the Alliance, but where did that data go? It was a beautiful index, and we talk so much about FAIR, findable, accessible, interoperable and reusable and all that sort of stuff. And you'll hear it about 20 more times, I hope, because when you go to computer science conferences, everybody talks about FAIR and findability. Well, it was a huge way to get into all these different systems. And gone. They got to lose that index from astronomy, aeronautics to zoology. You call it criminal. I wouldn't call it that, because I want funding from some of these agencies perhaps in the future, but I really, really miss it. Anyway, so my objective, the key takeaway, I have some high-level bullet points, nothing too serious and nothing that most people don't already know, but I'm just trying to hammer these points home about this historical data is invaluable for trend analysis and model generation and training systems. And we're only scratching the surface on artificial intelligence right now. It's got a long way to go, and if you think the amount of data we're seeing right now is enormous, which it is, more than ever before in humanity's history, we've got phenomenal amounts of data. Another couple more years, 5 years, 10 years, we're drowning in data. What are we going to do with it? Anyway, historical stuff, there's a mistake here. I wrote before this conference, impossible to reproduce, and then I heard Dr. Clare talk about air filters and reusing sources of information that to me is just incredible. And then the soil sediment folks are digging down. Now, I'm a little dicey on what the date was of when certain species were found, but historical data, maybe not quite impossible, or stick an asterisk beside that to say it's a little challenging to reproduce. But certainly, when we're doing species identification with fish studies and whatnot, we've got dates on the data, and it's very specific. They found this, et cetera, et cetera. Accelerating climate change, there's so many people out there trying to challenge that stuff. You can never have too much data. Well, this is the really scary slide to me, partly because I know how public school teachers used to evaluate my artwork, and it wasn't very good. So that, to me, drawing a dump truck, and those are in theory databases falling off into the e-waste dump. Does that ever happen? Sadly, it does. I remember 2,000 scientists being laid off from Environment Canada in 2014. And where did all their data go? It's not a happy story. The ministry at the time claimed that it was all preserved and archived and accessible and all this sort of stuff. The scientists said, no, it wasn't. It was on my laptop or whatever. It's gone. Has it happened since? Yep. And to me, part of what I preach today, I apologize if it sounds a little preachy, but for folks with gray hair and aging, coming up on retirement, what's going to happen to your data that you've collected in the last 10, 20, 30 years? You know, it's your life's work. Is it in a way where others can, in a place where others can use it and access it? Does it have value? Well, who knows? I can't always predict. One of the things I encourage people to think about is how will a future researcher decide if your data is of value to them or not? Are you providing enough metadata, data about the data, descriptive data? Are you providing enough descriptive data about that for that person in the future? So we can't predict who it'll be and what their subject area it is and all that sort of stuff. To make the decision, yeah, that's valuable stuff to me. How do we do that kind of decision and plan for it? Are you sure you want to permanently delete this file? Yeah, that's straight out of Windows, that's what they ask. Current permanent storage, I'm a user actually of GBIF. We get the ROM Zik Theology database. And we incorporate it into one of our systems for fish distribution sites. We merge it with it's called the Aquatic Resource Areas from the Ministry of Natural Resources. And 5, 6 or more years ago, they used to publish, when you do scientific collection in Ontario, you have to put in a research permit application and they'll approve it. But one of the clauses in there is to do a report. What did you catch? Where did you catch it? What the details of your study? And that data, I've seen the flow chart for the flow of information inside the ministry. Oh my goodness. It used to contain abundance information. When we went and downloaded these aquatic resource areas, as they call it, the ARA layer, it would match with the permit reports, mostly. Sometimes there were discrepancies, and we started to say, where'd that come from? And it had abundance information, like if you caught brown trout somewhere, or guppies, or minnows, or whatever, and I'm not a fish expert, that's for sure. But whatever you caught, it would say how many, and that's what's on the reports that got submitted. It made its way through. Today, when you download those layers, no abundance. It says these fish were caught in this location, and that's it, no quantity. And I went, oh man, what are they doing? They're trying to simplify their storage systems is what it is, because they've got hundreds of data sets, and they're trying to reduce it. Now it's gone from 3 to 2. DOIs, I'm a big fan of those, all good, except they have some issues with active data repositories. Ours is currently being, constantly being added to and extended. Even people make updates and changes to things. Archives and so on, current priorities. The bad news, did I hit that twice? I don't think so, that's all good. So what are we looking for? We're looking for some level of mandatory or obligation to get as raw a data as possible. Once it's been processed and proves the point that you're trying to research and paper and study or write up, chances are there's some pretty good biases in that data. So we're looking for metadata that says, what did you do, when did you do it, where, who done it, and we're trying to systematize the why. What were you looking for, and why did you choose this study site or that location to do whatever it is you're doing? National Conservation Strategy, that's the one liner that says what we're after. So I'll stop right there, and that's our group. Thank you.